So back in the day, Dallas was always about the Dallas Cowboys. Well, we're the most famous team in the entire world. And here you guys come with a new NBA basketball team. How tough was that to try to break into the consciousness of Dallas, Texas with a basketball team?
Well, it was tough, but the thing about it is that it was a great thing because it involved the whole community. They knew that, hey, we got a new baby here, we're gonna give it some time to grow. And I think that was just a fantastic thing because as we won, you could see the crowd going crazier and crazier. And of course, it was a whole community thing that was put together and it worked out really well.
You draft a guy like Sam Perkins, Rolando Blackman, Mark Aguirre, so on and so forth, sooner or later you're gonna catch on. And I think a lot of times about it, having a new opportunity sort of separates you, and I think we were able to build our own identity, you know, as the years went on, and you know, really it turned into something special.
I found that Texas fans are very proud of winning.
Understatement.
And I guess that's where the reunion rowdies came from. Mm-hmm. That would come in. Tell me about those guys.
I think they were rowdy because they didn't know what else to do. I mean, it's like during, it was a new team and everything. And so, you know, they turned out because of the fact that we were winning and it was interesting and it was different.
Blackman gives it up to Aguirre. Nice pass to Perkins.
And that's how it took off. And these people screaming and the rowdies, I mean, they all were made up just because we had nothing else to go on. You know, we were first team.
The Mavericks' first head coach, which you guys all played for, is Dick Motta. Tell me about Dick Motta.
You know, not the kind of guy you can spend time with and just find out what's going on and, you know, shoot the breeze and then go to bed. It wasn't that kind of a situation. It was rough. It was rough. You know, it was almost like a military situation. You come on in and you knew the drills was about to start and it's no smiling, no laughing, that kind of a thing. There was this fine line of you know, sometimes you want to say hello and maybe give a hug, but you just to throw a little tap, you know, how you doing this morning? That kind of a thing. It was just a different thing, but you knew at the end of the day that he was teaching the game and the way to play under pressure, which is what I loved about it. I learned how to play and execute when the pressure was at its highest.
I tell you what.
You go ahead, Mark.
I tell you what about Dick. We had our differences. We definitely had our differences. But the things that he taught me when I was here in Dallas allowed me to feel like when I played, I don't care who you are, that, you know, you can't guard me, and that guy next to you can't guard me either, because I know how to do it now.
Dick Motta encouraging vocally Mark Aguirre to play better.
Before, I was just talented, but he taught me how to do the things I needed to do in order to be a really good player.
In 1984, all the pieces are in place. That was the year that you guys made the first playoff appearance. Would you feel like it was all starting to come together?
You could see it coming.
The Mavericks on a break. Oh, what a move by Aguirre!
And you could see it on the face of the other teams, too.
And they're going to give Rowe the basket.
You can look at the other teams and they like, whoa.
You went so quickly from expansion team to having respect across the league in a short time. All of a sudden, you guys were immediate contenders.
As Harper goes the other way with it, drops it off to Perkins. And a three-point opportunity for the Mavericks.
Five straight trips to the playoffs, you guys were real. It wasn't like, you know, we don't want them in the first round. That's not the team we want in the first round.
It was that guy right there, man. We just kind of got right there. It was funny. I didn't see all that when 80 and 81, 82.
Yeah, so he didn't see none of that.
I'm thinking like this is how it is all the time. But I knew our odds, we weren't the favorite all the time, so. But with Roe maturing and Mark and Derek, you know, in their second and third years, I mean, it's just bound to happen. And as time went on, we competed every night, and you couldn't really get a win in reunion unless, you know, you were just absolutely hot.
And with Mata there, Mata's an excellent coach who does a great job with young people, and they're going to be a great powerhouse, perhaps a dynasty of the future like the Boston Celtics and the L.A. Lakers.
And it all tied back to Dick Mata, because Dick Mata wanted us to mature. We can talk about him, but we do miss him a little bit.
I care.
But
I care. Sure.
Dick Mata was the glue.
He's my guy.
Yeah, he made us. He made us.
A lot of times you have a coach that you don't really realize what that impact was on your life or on your game until way afterwards when you look back and realize like that guy was the glue.
The way he put it together was the beautiful thing about it, because see, he was like, well, I'm going to get Sam Perkins. I'm like, what's Sam Perkins going to do?
For us. I mean, come
appreciate
on.
That. Appreciate that.
Sam.
Sam, is this the first time you've heard this?
Let me get the back end of it. I'm like, Coach, what is Sam Perkins going to do for us? What is he going to do for us? You drafted Sam Perkins. He's like, look, you know, be quiet.
Okay, well, I'm with you, Coach.
It just was perfect chemistry. He freed me up, and then when Roy came along, I mean, you're talking about blossom at that point, because
we're going to take a break there, because when we come back, we're going to talk about Roy Tarpley and how you guys even got better.
Well, see, you don't know. I was Sam Perkins. Gee, what are you going to do for us?
That's the first time you heard that, isn't it, Sam?
Yeah, I guess so.
We'll be back with more right after this.